What does this have to do with democracy? It's a plutocracy, straight out. Now, there's a little pressure around the edges, but mostly on matters that are kind of peripheral to the centers of power. That's the United States. And none of this is graven in stone. Now you go back to the end of the Second World War, there was a wave of radical democracy over the whole world. The anti-fascist struggle, you know, that inspired people, took one form or another, communist, socialist, laborite, one thing or another. And the first goal of the victors, the United States and Britain, was to crush it. The history is really worth looking at. It started early on. The Britain in the after 45 was under the Labour Party. The first thing they did was in Italy. The American and British forces. Well, the first thing was actually in North Africa, where United States imposed basically the Vichy government, including a Nazi sympathizer, Darlan, Admiral Darlan. In Italy, there was a strong resistance movement, really strong. It was actually holding down six German divisions, not a small thing, not just blowing up a train here and there. And in fact, the Italian resistance pretty much liberated a good deal of Italy before the Allied forces got there. First thing they did, the U.S. and Britain behind them, was to try to reconstitute the traditional system, bring back the king, put it under the Field Marshal Badoglio, who was a fascist general, was put back in charge. As they moved up to the North had really been liberated by the resistance, and they had built their own society, a worker-based radical democratic society, worker-owned enterprises, cooperatives, the whole business. The British Labour Party was utterly horrified, the Americans even more so. They dismantled it and forcefully restored the traditional order. In 1948, there was going to be an election, and they were petrified that the left would win. So the United States, by then Britain was kind of out of it, the United States poured in money, all kind of subversion, threatened to withhold aid. Italy was kind of starving unless they voted the right for the Christian Democrats the right way. You'll go back to the State Department documents. They say, we have to institute policies so clear that the dumbest WOP will understand. That's Italy. And yeah, they managed to drive the election to the right. For the next 20 or 30 years, Italy was one of the, maybe the main target of CIA manipulation to try to keep the country to the right. That's Italy. Greece also had a very strong resistance movement, which again was holding down several Nazi divisions. The British went in first in 1944. Churchill ordered the British forces to treat Athens like a conquered city, smash up the domestic forces, and reconstitute the traditional quasi-fascist order, in fact, collaborators with the fascists. The British couldn't hold it down. They didn't have the force at that point, so they asked the U.S. to step in. We did, starting 1946, 47, famous Truman Doctrine. Ended up with a civil war, which probably maybe 150,000 Greeks were killed. The left was wiped out. There was a restoration of something like of the pretty much the traditional order, including fascist elements. Went on like that. Finally, in the early 60s, there was a literal fascist takeover, first restoration of a fascist regime in Europe. The U.S. strongly supported it. In fact, kept supporting it until 1974 was overthrown. That's Greek democracy. It goes on like that. In Germany, U.S. was very concerned about the labor movement in Germany, a lot of it inspired from the East. In fact, George Kennan, the great planner and statesman, he proposed building a wall to wall off Eastern Germany from the West, to prevent it from infecting the West. Nice image when you think about what the future was like. It kind of goes on like that. Meanwhile, the Russians were playing their own rotten games in the East. But there was a promise during the Second World War. Could have turned out differently. Didn't, you know, in some ways, good things happened. So formation of the European Union, not the euro currency, that's something different, but the European Union, the Schengen agreements and so on, those are real steps forward. And European social democracy was a step forward, now being beaten back. And when you talk about visions, that's extremely important. That's about as important as the environmental crisis. It's pressing us towards a possible nuclear war, which means the end quickly. There were, not so much at the end of the Second World War, but in 1990, there were competing visions, not the end of the Second World War. 1990, Soviet Union collapsed. What happens next? Well, there were competing visions. One of them was Gorbachev's, a Eurasian security system in which all would take part. There would be centers in Brussels and Moscow and Ankara and a kind of a joint security system. Both military alliances would collapse, NATO and Warsaw Pact. That's Gorbachev. The West wasn't having it. The United States in particular forced a different system in which the Warsaw Pact, of course, dissolved. NATO didn't, if you think about it, NATO was established theoretically in order to protect Western Europe from the Russian hordes. Okay, no more Russian hordes. So what do? You expand NATO and move NATO to the east in violation of verbal promises, not written ones. They were careful not to write it down. Verbal promises to Gorbachev. NATO started right away. First, Gorbachev agreed to let a united Germany join NATO, a hostile military alliance, which is a pretty remarkable concession if you look at history. But the condition, as he understood it, was that NATO would not move, the phrase was, 1 inch to the east, meaning East Germany. It wasn't written, it was a verbal promise, so it was immediately withdrawn. Later years, NATO moved further to the east. Now it's moving to the geopolitical heartland of Russian security interests, Ukraine. There have been several explicit demands by NATO that Ukraine join NATO. No matter who was running Russia, you know, Gandhi, they wouldn't accept this. And that's extremely dangerous. And right along the border now, it's a very dangerous situation. Just not long ago, U.S. tanks and maneuvers in Estonia were a couple hundred meters from the Russian border. A Russian plane a couple of months ago, a military plane with its transponder off, practically hit a Danish commercial airliner, just barely missed it. These things are happening regularly, and it's building up tensions very seriously. There was recently an article by William Perry, who's former defense secretary, a very kind of conservative, serious military analyst, no dove at all, who warned that the danger of nuclear war now is higher than it was during the Cold War. Well, those are different visions coming from 1989, 1990. There were also different visions during the Second World War. Policies, their class interests that overwhelm what populations might have wanted. Not total loss, a lot of gains, but not what it could have been. And I think that can be reconstituted. These things are not very far below people's consciousness. Could be reawakened.